All right. Down there. So we're talking today about ROCOR theologians. And when I mean ROCOR, of course I mean Russian Church Abroad, but also we can speak more widely about Russian diaspora. And who is the most prominent of Russian Church Abroad theologians, James? Bishop Averky is a local one, so definitely this sends a message that you are from Georgia. That's okay. But any, can you give any other tries? There is higher level than Averky. Averky, he's known in Russia, his New Testament works, like Holy Scripture commentaries and so on. In this sense, can you think any bigger names than him? Metropolitan Anthony Kapovitsky. Because he belongs to the entire Russian Church, and Bishop Averky more or less is like Jordan Goodbrand, which is fine. But Metropolitan Anthony Kapovitsky, he belongs to the entire Russian Church. Because he was known already before the revolution as a writer, as a prolific writer, and he belonged to this late 19th century school. They try to unpack what, to explain basically what happened during the earthly ministry of Christ. How does this apply to you, to your particular life? Because what happened, people would study in gymnasium, their schools and seminaries. Law of God, and it was taught very systematically and without any soul, very sort of dry, that it was easy to lose your faith, right? And then simple questions like St. Nicholas of Japan was asked in Japan, how you're saying that your God is good, but how come that he is good if he didn't prevent his son from suffering? What kind of father was he that he didn't prevent? So, and this is very sensible questions, and those questions, they were not really considered. You basically take everything just a spoon feed, and you either accept it or reject, and many people reject because it wasn't really something that they were ready to be convinced. And Metropolitan Anthony, he challenged this, and he would start explaining how what was done in Gethsemane, how it was done on the cross, really how this can be applied to your life. And that's why he and his disciple, Metropolitan Sergei Strogorodsky, who despite the fact that they were in different camps, ecclesiastical camps, they nevertheless were very strongly connected. And Metropolitan Anthony used to have Panagia with the quote from New Testament about wise virgins, right? And there was quote, give us from your oil. And that was the Panagia from Metropolitan Sergei Strogorodsky to Metropolitan Anthony. And he really was thinking a lot about him, despite the fact that he confronted him and saying that what he did in his tenure in his second period was wrong. Nevertheless, I think he would do the same thing as he did to Metropolitan Evlogia, right? As they were also bitterly criticized each other, but when Metropolitan Evlogia came to Belgrade, you remember who was Metropolitan Evlogia, right? Do you?
Yeah.
Okay, so when he came to Belgrade in 1935, Metropolitan Anthony was very, very generous in the reception and even asked Metropolitan Evlogia to read the prayer of absolution over him. So I think if somehow they would meet with Metropolitan Sergei, they also would have very, very amicable, very friendly meeting with each other, right? So, and two of them, they strove they work hard in order to make Christianity relevant to contemporaries, also explain what Holy Fathers believe, so maybe bring Holy Fathers back, and now it's all this received name of a neo-patristic sort of renaissance of the 19th century, kind of in the 18th century, the official language of Russian theological schools was Latin. And it was a bit sort of schizophrenic because native language of students was Russian, and then they studied all theological subjects through the medium of Latin, because it was like still in Russia and maybe in Ukraine, if you get prescription is in Latin. I don't know, it used to be in my case during the Soviet Union. So because Latin was considered official language, and it's still considered, if you go to law school, you would get some class on Latin terminology, because it's like professional language, there are a lot of Latin in law school, so on. And here was the same thinking, right? And all manuals were taken either from Protestants or Roman Catholics. And they're calling fathers and we know him and we like, you guys listen during Frost Week when you have like heavy dosage of Desert Fathers and so on. That really wasn't on radars, mainly in school. Because in school you would study Latin in order to have classes in Latin, then you would give a sermon in Latin, and then you are prepared to go to a parish in a village where you would never need it. It would help you because it sort of brought you to a higher intellectual level for your personal development. You can look up a source in Latin and so on. But then it wasn't probably useful, and it's also contributed to this division between flock and clergy. Like, because for flock, Latin didn't really mean much, and you're not going to preach in Latin any longer in your parish. So it all changed in 19th century, and it's a change even more with Metropolitan Anthony towards the end of the 19th century. I'm not saying, you know, that he was the only one who contributed to this. It's totally wrong, because at times in Russian church abroad, people just think, all right, Metropolitan Anthony, he kind of was the only single person. No, that's the thing, that he represented one theological school of thought, and he was personally very comfortable with strict attitudes. Like, he was a proponent, he was a follower of St. Cyprian of Carthage. And St. Cyprian of Carthage, who died in 256, he was a bishop in North Africa, very influential. He left his letters, and he explained his ecclesiology, because in North Africa, in the 4th century, there were schismatics, right, donatists. And St. Cyprian expressed his vision, or his understanding, that all those donatists, they didn't belong to the Orthodox Church any longer, they're just outside of the Orthodox Church. And they have no baptism, and it was his approach. But then in the 5th century, Blessed Augustine, also North Africa, of Nippo, Bishop of Nippo in North Africa, he kind of came up with different explanation. He said, no, those Donatists, they still belong to the church, because they didn't go too far away from the church in their teaching. But their lack of repentance, lack of love, didn't help them to benefit from baptism of the church that they received. So they need to reconcile with the church in order to become good members of the church. So, and we have these two attitudes as the Orthodox Church, and sometimes church uses, I think Russian church especially, mostly uses Blessed Augustine explanations for this question of, but as you see, St. Cyprian's views, they're also popular. In Metropolitan Anthony, he was the one, and St. Ilarion of Vireas and Ilarion Troitsky, he also was a disciple of Metropolitan Anthony, who would come up with very similar explanations. But this is an ongoing debate. It's really unfair to say that church believes in one way or another, because both points of view, they coexist. That's also why he's important. And when he was Archbishop of Kharkov before the revolution, he engaged in polemics with Robert Garrett. Not in polemics, I think it was more like exchange of ideas, because polemics is a negative word, from the Greek word polemeo, to wage war. And he was just sort of express his ideas and they exchanged views with Robert Gardiner, who became the founder of the Conference on Faith and Order. Now this conference is part of World Council of Churches. And he invited somebody from the Russian Church to come and talk to them. Metropolitan Antony said, yes, we would come and talk, but we're not going to dilute our faith, we're not going to compromise in our faith, we would just speak up the way we believe. And that's what I really like. You do come, you do talk, so, and you talk respectfully, cordially, openly, but then you stand your ground. You explain that, I'm sorry, but that's what church believes on this, right? That's what we believe as Orthodox. So, all right. And that's what Metropolitan and Archbishop Antony did. But then, nevertheless, he was open to come and meet with non-Orthodox and talk. That, I think, is important. But then Russian Revolution stops this. And he asked to send last letter to this Robert Gardiner. At that time, he was a layman, Vladimir Troitsky. And he later became Archbishop Ilarion. So you see how it's all connected. Then Metropolitan Antony, when he was in Serbia, right, he drafted a catechism. And in that catechism, he emphasized a lot what he believed was right, that he was arguing that you cannot just limit Christ's redemption to the cavalry, to the cross. What happened in Gethsemane was part of this. You see that this is a package deal, basically, right? And some people were uncomfortable, and they even called Metropolitan Antony that he was a cross fighter, that he was fighting against cross, right? And but to show his his attitude, I should say that he said, well, that's fine. If you're unhappy with this, I'm going to take it back. And that shows that he was not heretical. Even if you have a problem with this, with his views, right, they remain his personal views, because in order to become a heretic, you would start to push your agenda. So, like, no, I know it's better. I've been studying it all my life. You don't get it. That's exactly how it is. And that's what turns. That was basically this cross line that you cross, and when one becomes heretic, when somebody starts to oppose his personal views to the church. So you can have your views, you can even can be mistaken, but as long as you don't really insist, you're not heretic, right? But when you have maybe you don't understand something, maybe in some areas it wasn't defined of theology clearly, right? You might be entitled to have this view, but as long as you not really push it. So, and he didn't push it. So that means that his spirit, so he was still a humble man. So that's what comes to my mind regarding Metropolitan Antony. And since time is limited, I also would like to jump into modern times in the 20th century America and mention Father Seraphim Rose. And Father Seraphim Rose, he was a very different story, right? He was not of a Russian background at all. He was not of Orthodox background at all, right? He grew up in California. And as the same way as Timothy Ware, Callistus Ware, who also was there for one time, member of the Russian Church abroad, even trying to be a monastic in a monastery in Montreal under Bishop Vitalian Ustinov. So at the same time as Callistus Ware, who just happened to come up on a ROCOR parish in London, so the same way Father Seraphim Rose, when he was Eugene Rose, he came up on the Russian Church in San Francisco, and then he met his long-time friend, Gleb Mashevsky, who was an alumnus of the seminary. Very few people now remember him. Father Victor does remember him, and Father Victor keeps saying that it was a mistake for him to come and set up a monastery in Platina. He would have been better off as a future Father German if he stayed in Jordan and would help to develop the monastery press. So, and two of them initially wanted to be lay brothers, right? So basically like to work for church, printing books, but not be monastics. But after the death of St. John of Shanghai, Archbishop Anthony of San Francisco was sent there, and Archbishop Anthony of San Francisco didn't really want to have anything like that because it was something not very traditional. Because traditionally you are either a layman or a monk, but you don't talk about the two lay people live together, printing books and so on, you have like lay brotherhood. It wasn't something very usual, special that Archbishop Anthony, he was a full schema monk, tortured in Milkova in the same monastery where Father Fadier, right, you know this Father Fadier, mm-hmm. Your source of German
lives.
Right, and he received his monastic instructions in this monastery set up by Russians in Milkova. And from that monastery, that's when Lev Ivanovich was initially, right, so our elder, right, who connects us with this first generation of Russian bishops. That's where the two Antonys of Russian Church abroad, where St. John of Shanghai was, right, and Father Kiprian Keru was. And then there are a number of people, of ROCOR people, who were there. So that's from where Archbishop Anthony came up. And Archbishop Anthony didn't want to support anything. And he said, if you want to do things like that, you should be monks. So they accepted this, and he tortures them monks. And Father Seraphim Rhodes, he was very prolific, but he used Western training, like research training, skills that he received in college, that he received in Western academia, in order to write about orthodoxy. And that's good, because it gives you a sort of give legitimate status to non-orthodox studies, so you can still use your training for when you study the same way as great Cappadocian fathers and Basil the Great and St. Gregory the theologians, they used their education and efforts. So I think it's comparable. And he came up with his work, Life After Death, Father Seraphim Rhodes. And this work, Life After Death, he was writing about toll houses. And then a deacon of the Russian Church abroad, who also spent little time, sometime, who lives in Jordanville, Lev Puhala, he challenged Father Seraphim Rhodes, said, no, what you're saying is wrong, you're misquoting holy fathers. And this was happening in the 1970s. And they had polemics, like Puhala. He was speaking about what is called like sleeping souls, basically. He argued against toll houses, saying, no, that basically what you are saying, it's a Gnostic idea, it's not true. So, but it's interesting that Russian Church abroad had really full-blown polemics, like the same way as what happened like in ancient church. So at the end of the day, Puhala was found by the Russian synod basically not right, and was prohibited to speak about sleeping souls, and he was later suspended and defrocked. Okay.
Cool.
Lazar Puhal. He's mm-hmm. now Lazar in monasticism, but his name in the Russian Church abroad was Lev. So, but that was discussion. Another thing also that Father Seraphim Rhodes, he argued very much in favor of creationism. Right, and there were some other theologians said, no, listen, you can find there is some evolution, even like if you think about the 6 days of creation by St. Basil, you see there is some gradation, there is some development. So again, there was, and this is his book that was recently republished by Platina on regarding creation. So, and you can see Russian Church abroad had really sort of interesting theological polemics. Right, So, and of course, there were fathers in Germany whom you mentioned, like Archbishop Averki, and also Father Mikhail Pomazansky, who was an alumnus of Kyiv Theological Academy. So he had a good command of Latin, good command of Byzantine Greek. But Jordanville mostly, and also there was Father Konstantin Zaitsev, right? Father Konstantin Zaitsev, he didn't receive any theological education, but he was a Russian intellectual, and he was talking about necessity of having monarchy in Russia, about necessity of drive closer to the ideal of Holy Rus. That became a big point in Jordan, so the Svetaya Rus, right? But it was idealization of a lifestyle, basically. If you look at Father Kyprian's, all Father Kyprian's postcards, right? You can see there are a lot of idealizations, like people, you know, celebrating Easter and so on. And that's how Holy Rus was basically meant, right? And of course, they would admit that there were problems, but also they would idealize it a lot. And at the same time, they didn't really want to see complexity of the modern Russia, because modern Russia after revolution was treated more or less as a negative thing, because every fixation was with communism, right? But people did live there. But that gives you ideas about developments in Jordanville, more or less on defensive way, because Jordanville was concerned about theological thinking of like Paris School of Theology and their developments, and Jordanville therefore defined itself as a place where traditional orthodoxy is preserved, and they embrace very careful attitudes to all novelties, right? Okay, so that gives you some ideas.
Traditional orthodoxy for the 21st century.